Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Resources for the Future. As we celebrate our 60th anniversary, we're trying to focus on critical issues of the next decade that have an intersection with economic growth, with the environment, with risks. And as you know, we've had a Nobel Laureate series of speakers that are still available on our website. And we've tried to turn our first Wednesday series into something that looks ahead to the next decade. We call it, the theme is Resources 2020. Now, I realize this is the third Tuesday, and I have this impulse to use a cynical old joke in this town, which is close enough for Washington work. However, the reason, of course, we picked this date is because it's when we could get the distinguished panelists that you are about to hear from, and we're very grateful to them for taking the time and participating this morning. And certainly, an enduring theme in the work here at RFF over the last 60 years, at least it's a theme that reemerges over and over, is with scientific and with technological advancement, how do we best assess the potential benefits to mankind, and how do we assess any risk that there might be to mankind or the environment, and if there are risks, how do we manage those risks, kind of proposition. And of course, our scholars have been deeply involved in how to do the analysis of these kind of problems, as well as to identify them and to articulate them for the broader both research and public policy community. Well, today, as you know, the title of our topic is Agricultural Biotechnology and the Environment, and certainly this raises those themes in a pronounced way. But we're very pleased to have with us at RFF and leading our effort today, Randall Lutter. Randy is a visiting scholar here at RFF, and he has done the considerable difficult work of organizing this particular event. But Randy has a wealth of experience apart from his intellectual achievements as an economist. He has served at the Council of Economic Advisors. He's served at the Office of Management and Budget. And at the FDA, he has served for many years, as well as becoming Deputy Commissioner for Policy. And relevant to today's topic, one of the significant items that he led at the Food and Drug Administration was to establish what the guidance is, how they will use and interpret their authority that they have to regulate or to assess these questions of when animals are genetically modified and they become in the food chain, how should the regulatory system approach these kind of questions. Now, as you can tell, this subject is rather foreign to me, so I may not have expressed that totally, so that's why I want to quickly turn it over to Randy to lead the day. Thanks, Randy.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction. And my job today is moderator. So I'm going to spend a few minutes introducing the topic of ag biotech and the environment, and framing presenting some common knowledge about it, and then turning over to a panel of very distinguished experts that I'm pleased to have here today. There's a page of detailed biographies on the professional backgrounds of all of them, so I'd like not to spend time on that right now, but instead turn to that a little bit later. With respect to terminology, I know we have a very unusual audience here in terms of the variety of backgrounds. So I'm using the language biotech, which is sometimes thought of as genetic engineering. You can think of that as a deliberate manipulation of DNA through recombinant DNA techniques to introduce to an organism new and altered traits. It's sometimes thought of as genetic modification, but that's really what has made my dog my dog. My dog's a mutt, golden retriever, and black lab, and that's not engineering. And the breeder who produced him would emphatically assert that. It's a lovely dog. So GE enables people to introduce to an organism a range of wide traits, which is much larger than you might be able to get through conventional breeding. It's become really widespread. These are data from a consortium that follows use of GE seeds in crops, and the labeling of the vertical axes is actually acres and then hectares. But the phenomenon over the last 15 years is extraordinary. For soybean, maize, cotton, and canola, huge acreage worldwide is now planted in GE varieties. In the United States, the pattern is very similar. The percent of total U.S. acreage planted in selected crops for key crops is the vast majority of all acreage. For soybeans, 93%, for corn, 88%, and for cotton, 94%. And I've also presented here information on the number of companies that are actively marketing GE seeds for these crops. The most common trait of these crops is herbicide tolerance. But there's many others as well. There's 180 products cleared for food use in the United States. By product, I mean a particular trait in a particular food. One could be more specific and refer to an event that generated that trait, and that's actually what's meant here, 180. So, and it's a wide variety. It's alfalfa, canola, chicory, corn, flax, melon, tomato, wheat, and you might say, well, you don't eat all of these, but in many manufactured products, you might be surprised. Tomato soup contains wheat, for example. The government oversight is quite complex, and it's largely, if you will, a phenomenon of a square peg having been fit into a round hole. When the legislation was originally enacted, people didn't know how these GE techniques would evolve or be used or what promise they might pose. So the regulators, having been one at FDA, asked, what can we do with existing authority for which there might be a sensible basis for bringing products to market in a manner that manages risk carefully? And I've played some role in that, but not in this particular case. So government oversight includes a function of three separate agencies. The Food and Drug Administration engages in a voluntary consultation for GE plants with respect to food safety, and that's been in place for at least 15 years, probably longer. The Environmental Protection Agency has a mandatory pre-market review and registration process for pesticide tolerances and pesticidal substances, and they have statutory authority for that. The U.S. Department of Agriculture, APHIS, Animal Plant Health Inspection Service, has regulations of organisms and products that are known or suspected to be plant pests or to pose a plant pest risk. So there's three separate agencies that have authority. And there's some really unusual products in the pipeline, ones that have revolutionary potential. One that's been quite prominent is called golden rice. And for people who follow global health issues, this is the sort of dream that people would have envisioned decades ago, or at least it can be seen that way. It's reported to be nearing approval in developing countries where it would be most important. The WHO estimates that between 250,000 and 500,000 vitamin A deficient children become blind yearly, and nearly half of them die by 12 months after losing their sight. The vitamin A deficiency is widespread, and this golden rice would introduce a precursor to vitamin A into rice, a very, very common staple in poor countries, and thereby help address this vitamin deficiency in a low-cost way. Not yet approved. It's been under development for 10 years. In early stages, and therefore not necessarily successful in any time soon, but in early stages, our efforts to develop nitrogen-fixing cereals, such as corn, and they could get nitrogen from the air in the same way that peas and beans do, and rather than needing energy-consuming fertilizers, also reducing emissions of nitrous oxide. Would it work? Who knows? That's what one has researchers engaged in. But if it does, that's potentially beneficial in terms of influencing the human footprint on the Earth. There's also a collection of animal products, which are timely these days in part because of a recent announcement by the Food and Drug Administration just before Christmas. They released a draft environmental impact statement on a fast-growing salmon. But there's many other products. There's a mastitis-resistant breed of cattle. As best I can tell from the web, the development is stalled. The USDA has reported that mastitis causes damages of around $2 billion annually. It's an inflammation of the udder that requires antibiotics to treat and reduces the productivity of dairy cows. There's an EnviroPig developed in Canada. That's a trademark name. It has several advantages for people interested in either reducing costs of complying with environmental regs or improving the quality of waterways. It would reduce the phosphorus in excrement by 20 or 60%, think eutrophication of waterways. Development has been frozen after 10 generations. I pick frozen as the word because that's the status of the material, literally. Another interesting example is chickens. There's a variety under development in the UK that reduces transmissibility of bird flu, sometimes called H5N1. You may not remember, but about 5 or 6 years back, there was an epidemic of bird flu in the Far East and reports that it had gotten as far as Europe. There were public requests for the resignation of the head of the European Food Safety Agency after he stated that eggs from chicken farms could be eaten safely without risk to human health. I mention that as an example of just the depth of emotion and public outcry associated with a new infectious disease in animal flocks or herds. This chicken that reduces transmissibility of bird flu is under development, and the institute in the UK is not planning on FDA approval or by other agencies as part of its model. And then there's salmon. It's the Aqua Bounty has a salmon, which is the subject of the recent announcement by the Food and Drug Administration. Decision has been pending. Maybe that's pending is not the right word there. It's the FDA has had data on it since the mid-1990s. There was a Federal Advisory Committee Act meeting in 2010. The draft announcement came out with a finding of no significant impact last December, and the agency has recently extended the public comment period by 60 days following a letter from U.S. senators. Of course, this is only what's known to be in the pipeline. There's a collection of other products that are potentially in the pipeline, but one may or may not ever observe those, depending on how much research and development effort goes on. From an environmental protection perspective, one might ask, is there a product that would reduce methane emissions from sheep, a source of some concern for people interested in controlling global warming? Are there animals other than the salmon for which there would be faster growth, more animal product per unit feed? Labeling has been attracted some attention. FDA cannot mandate labeling unless there's material differences in the composition of the food or its nutritional, functional, or organoleptic properties. That means how it feels, tastes, and cooks. But there's discontent with that. Last November, California had a Prop 37 on the ballot. It would have required labeling of foods made with GE materials, and it lost, but somewhat narrowly. Very expensive campaign to all sides on that. There's comparable actions and bills under development in other states, and the recent letter from U.S. senators mentioned pending federal legislation that would be introduced. It's clearly an open question how far that would evolve. Labeling has been different in different jurisdictions around the world. In the EU, food and feed must carry a label which acknowledges the presence in their wording, genetically modified organisms, except if the food or feed contains, consists of, or is produced in a proportion no higher than 0.9% of the food feed ingredients considered individually, and if this presence is adventitious or technically unavoidable. And now you realize that, of course, regulations may in principle be simple, but figuring out the details is always complicated. Perhaps as a result, or perhaps independently, the EU has had fewer acres or hectares planted in genetically engineered crops than, say, Uruguay. And I mentioned Uruguay. You might say, well, that's an oddball comparison, but it's actually more or less the size of Spain, and the EU has many more countries than simply Spain. And I mentioned Uruguay because one doesn't think of that as a fountain of innovation or cutting-edge scientific endeavors relative to, say, the historical role that Europe has played in that regard. Ag biotech, what I'd like to do is ask the panelists in a way, because this echoes the theme that our President Sharp laid out, resources for the future, has clearly a stance with regard to the future. So the question is, where will we be in 10 years? And what I hesitate to say vision, because that has connotations of both dreams and nightmares. So maybe simply, what scenario do you have in mind? And there's clearly several that one can imagine based on the facts that I've given. But I'm really a generalist in this matter. Some of the people here are not. So one possible competing forecast would be widespread use of GE plants and of GE animals approved by FDA, because that's currently the regulatory scheme set up by the agency in which I admittedly had a part, and GE products subject to mandatory labeling only if the differences are material. A separate competing forecast would be quite different, and perhaps that of some embraced by some critics, use in the U.S. and select trading partners of GE plants labeled based on a right-to-know basis. And presumably many of the people who advocated Prop 37 in California would view that as something that ought happen, if not might happen. Label based on right-to-know and no use of approved GE animals. And maybe that's too harsh or maybe not, but the thing about GE animals is the pipeline needs incentives, and if there's no incentives, then maybe the pipeline runs bare, and there's been, as we'll see in the course of the day, delays. So those are the two visions I have, and I'm going to have asked the panelists, well, what do you foresee 10 years from now, and what do you think might be a good goal, and what steps we can take to get there? The way I've outlined this is we'll hear in turn from three of our panelists with scientific backgrounds, and I think I have them in alphabetical order. Perhaps that's serendipity. And then after that, we'll hear from Bill McConaughey, who has an extensive background in FDA, in the Office of the Chief Counsel, and in the Office of the Commissioner, and we'll talk about FDA's labeling and authorities and constraints that it faces in that regard. And then finally, we'll turn to Pauline Ippolito, who has been so exceptionally gracious in accepting on very short notice. It was only Friday morning that I was thrilled to hear she said yes, and I'm really pleased to have you join us today, not only because it was such a nice gesture, but because you actually have wonderful expertise that matches the interests of the panel. So thank you, Pauline. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Fedoroff, whom I'm thrilled to have speak here today. So thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for this opportunity. I have 9 minutes, and what I'd like to say, first and last, is that most of what people believe about GMOs is the exact opposite of the truth. Let's see how far I can get. People worry about the dangers of genetic modification. We now have been carrying out research with genetically modified plants. I did some of the first of it, and it's now about 30 years, and there is no evidence. Zero, zip evidence that modifying plants by molecular techniques has special dangers associated with it. That's a different statement from saying, is it possible to generate a dangerous plant? It is possible to generate a dangerous plant. That depends on the context, what you want it to do, what it's producing, how it's different from other plants, what environment you put it in. And it matters not at all how it was modified. What matters is what the plant is. To make this real, we brought in kudzu vine. This is a perennial pest in this area. It was brought in to control soil erosion. Does that very well, but it's out of context, and it kind of went wild, and you know what damage it does ecologically. If you're expressing highly bioactive proteins in a plant, you have to be much more careful than if you introduce a trait that is perfectly innocuous. The traits that have been introduced and are being grown on many millions of hectares are pretty innocuous. The herbicide tolerance. Herbicides and insecticides are all called pesticides, technically. People don't differentiate between them very clearly. Herbicides are things that kill plants. They usually kill them by mechanisms that have no effect on people or animals. Pesticides are things that kill animals. They're little animals. It takes a lot more to kill a person than an animal, but a pesticide and an insecticide and an herbicide are two very different things. Okay, so biosafety, my bottom line is that biosafety is a function of the crop, the plant, not of the method by which it was modified. In the 20th century, we used chemical mutagens and radiation to modify plants. These are essentially scattershot methods. People planted them out, no one regulated it, and people looked through millions of plants for the traits that they wanted, and they threw away the rest. Nobody worried about it. All of a sudden, because we've devised some of the best and least damaging techniques we've ever had, everybody is worried about it. Okay, what about the benefits? Well, the traits that have been incorporated into our major commodity crops so far are not traits that were intended to increase yield. Many people say, oh, gee, well, biotech doesn't do anything for crop yield. Well, it does, because it reduces losses. The benefits are not all in increased yield. Herbicide tolerance, which, by the way, can be devised and was devised long before GM by other techniques, by spontaneous mutations and so forth, has made one of the biggest contributions to controlling soil erosion, incorporated into something called no-till farming, where people do not plow, decreases CO2 emissions, decreases from the soil and from the tractors, of course, and control soil erosion. So those are the kinds of benefits. The pesticide, the BT corn, cotton, that is a very well-known modification. That's a gene from a bacterium that has been used for many, many decades. It's a gene that encodes a little protein that's toxic to certain kinds of larvae of insect pests, but not to people. We don't have the receptors. So it's about as safe as you can get. What are the benefits? The benefits are that spraying a field with a pesticide, with an insecticide, kills upwards of 80 or 90% of the insects in it. The insect-resistant crops affect only those larvae that happen to chew on it. So the bottom line is that there are more insects, more biodiversity, so it's good for the environment. What about human health? Again, there is no evidence that the genetic modifications that are in the food and feed supply have any impact on human health. What you have to realize is that although the FDA approval is not mandatory, companies who bring crops to market do all the testing that is required. Often it's through three agencies, as you heard from Randy. And bottom line is, and just going back to the very first hearings that FDA had, is that after many millions of dollars spent in analyzing the first genetically modified tomato, I remember the final slide that the FDA presenter put up was, the genetically modified tomato is a tomato. And that's pretty much the bottom line. Okay, what about the urban myths? The urban myths get to market faster than the crops do. It's cheaper. But most of them, Terminator technology you've heard of, nobody's signaling me yet. Okay, so I have a few minutes. Terminator technology is an idea that got a bad name and a whole lot of bad press and never got off paper. I've had people get really mad at me when I tell them this because they're convinced that those terrible biotech companies are out there with Terminator genes. But let me just explain what it was meant to do, and as I said, it never got off paper. Many people worried about genetically modified seeds and pollen getting out of fields early on, and this was a proposal to design a kind of seed that would only germinate if you applied a particular chemical. As I said, number one, scientifically, it's hard to do, and number two, it got a bad name and never got off never got off paper. Okay. Human health benefits. It turns out that a real unexpected result, although if you thought about it ahead of time, you probably would have guessed it would be true, is that grains, corn is our biggest crop, GM crop, are often, the corn is often contaminated with toxic molecules that are made by fungi that get into the plant. The primary pest that is that the insect, the BT corn, protects against is a boring insect. It makes holes in the plant, gets into the plant, eats the inside out, the plant collapses, and you don't harvest anything. But it also is true that the fungi follow the insects into the plant through the holes that the insects bore. No holes, no fungi, much, much lower levels of mycotoxins, sometimes an order of magnitude less. And frankly, that's true of any kind of conventionally grown corn and organically grown corn. Often is discarded because of too high mycotoxin levels. Now, okay. Well, I think the last thing that I want to say is that people worry a lot about hypothetical risks. There's a difference between a hypothetical risk and a real risk. There are real risks associated with nuclear power. They can be addressed, they can be controlled, but there are real risks, and we've all found that out in a big way through the Fukushima disaster. After 30 years, the risks associated with using genetic modification by molecular techniques remain hypothetical. And that's really all I want to say. Okay. Should I take a couple questions now or later? What's your pleasure?
Maybe later, and we'll turn now to another panel.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, I'm going to try to run through a couple slides quickly. Let's see if I can bring this up. Okay. First, I want to thank the organizers, Randy and Researchers for the Future, for inviting us, and I'm glad to be here. I think it will be an interesting discussion. I'm going to take a little different tack than Dr. Fedoroff, although perhaps we can get to some of the issues that she brought up about direct risks and benefits. I agree with some, I disagree with others, and I'll probably illustrate that a little bit. But To me, the biggest risks and the biggest challenges that we have regarding agriculture, whether it's biotech or other forms of agriculture, are substantial right now. Agriculture has a huge land footprint. The way we do agriculture in the U.S., industrial agriculture, is highly productive, but I would argue not very sustainable. It has huge resource impacts and so on and so forth. It's challenging for pest control because when you grow huge acreages of single crops, you select for resistance and large numbers of pests and damage and so on. And I'm going to argue that genetic engineering, as it's in crops, as it's developed now and for the foreseeable future, not entirely, but to a significant extent, exacerbates these problems overall. You know, some of the other problems with industrial agriculture, this is a dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico. We have similar issues with the Chesapeake Bay, about 400 of these around the world. This is largely due to nitrogen over-fertilization in the upper Midwest and manure applications and so on. So these are having huge impacts on fisheries and need to be dealt with now. They're going to get worse as population increases and if we try to boost productivity and so on. So these are real risks and real impacts. Climate change, water use, we use 70% of our water to grow our crops now as population increases. These are going to be huge challenges. They already are, but we need to address them. And so to me, the big risk issues, one way or another, are how are any of our agricultural technologies, including genetic engineering, set to deal with these, how are they dealing with them now, and so on. The current bunch of crops, Randy listed a bunch of them, but 99% or more of the crops are herbicide tolerant or insect resistant with just a couple different traits, mainly a handful of crops. Wheat and so on are not out there commercially as genetically engineered crops. But we now, as a recent study, a survey that was just published suggests because these crops are used in encouraging industrial agriculture and the heavy use of these herbicides that these crops were designed for has resulted in resistant weeds that now infest 50 to 60 million acres and are increasing herbicide use. One thing I disagree with Nina about is, yes, insecticides are probably usually more harmful to a broader spectrum of organisms than herbicides, but herbicides can have harmful effects either through drift to surrounding vegetation, which is very important for biodiversity, or directly. And with Roundup, it's not so much the active ingredient, which has been implicated possibly as an endocrine disruptor, although I don't think there's nearly enough evidence yet to know one way or another. But the surfactant, which EPA does not regulate the so-called inert ingredients very carefully or rigorously, for example, there's good evidence that it potentially can harm amphibians in the field at field level concentrations, although that hasn't been substantiated in the field yet. So overall pesticide use in the U.S. because of this greatly increased use of herbicides has gone up. And this is causing real problems. This is Stanley Culpepper, a weed scientist at University of Georgia, standing in what is supposed to be a cotton field. You can see one or two cotton plants near the foreground, looking pretty miserable. These weeds are causing huge practical problems. That last slide I showed you estimates that over 50% of farms in the U.S. growing these crops now have these weeds. In this part of the country where Stanley is, it's about 92%. Farmers are literally going out of business. Nina mentioned no-till, which is a helpful process. It mostly occurred before biotech. It's not dependent on biotech. It was incentivized by farm bills in the 1980s and better seed drills, and most of the increase in no-till and conservation tillage acreage occurred prior to the introduction of biotech crops. They've probably increased it a marginal amount and make it easier to do that, but we're losing that to these resistant weeds, and that will increase erosion and so on. They're going back to hand hoeing in some of these farms. And as Nina argued, glyphosate Roundup is considered one of the less harmful herbicides compared to some others, but the industry answer to those crops is to produce crops resistant to older herbicides, 2,4-D dicamba. 2,4-D was developed in the 1940s. It's been implicated through a number of epidemiological studies, or I would say not proven, to increase non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and several other diseases in farmers and farm workers who get exposed to this at much higher levels than we do as consumers. But this is from Mortensen et al., a weed scientist at Penn State, looking at the prospect of these crops and projecting possible, this is, you know, a rough estimate, increases in herbicide use over time, because again, this is designed for industrial agriculture. That's where this technology is mainly going, mainly been. And so it's mainly a pesticide technology. And it's probably, it may be futile. There are already populations of water hemp, one of the worst of these weeds in the Midwest, that are already resistant to several herbicides, including some of the ones in the next generation of herbicide-resistant crops, such as 2,4-D and isoxaflutyl. And several weed scientists are concerned that we may be actually running out of herbicides to control these crops. The use of these crops and the pesticides used on them do have biodiversity impacts. I can only get into a few of them, but milkweeds are very effectively controlled by glyphosate and drift from glyphosate. And that, it's an unintended consequence, but it's a real one. As far as, there's a number of studies now that show that the population of milkweeds that monarch butterfly larvae depend on for their food on their annual migration through the Midwest has been greatly reduced. And although we don't know exactly what impacts this has on its populations, it's hard to imagine that it won't have some. And this is just, I think, you know, one example that we've looked at. Something that Nina mentioned, which is, it's true that the insecticide, chemical insecticide use has been reduced on some of these crops, and that's a good thing. But because, again, this is part of a monoculture agriculture system, they've been largely replaced with neonicotinoid insecticide seed treatments because these crops only protect a small number from a small number of pests. These are probably safer for farm workers, although the dust from applying them may be an issue. But there's mounting evidence, a lot of evidence now, that they are harmful to bees and other pollinators and other beneficial species. GE, because as it's being developed, and again, I'm arguing that the large bulk of the developments are from the industry and will continue to be around these pesticide technologies, are reinforcing and encouraging this kind of agriculture. This is from Mortensen, concern about moving away from some of the better practices. Michael Gray at University of Illinois, a very mainstream entomologist who says, due primarily to the escalating use of BT transgenic hybrids, we may be developing resistance and so on. We're already seeing now resistance to several insects, especially rootworm in the Midwest, and that will probably lead to increased insecticide use, reversing earlier trends. What are the prospects for genetic engineering for addressing some of these other issues? We have now, in terms of climate change, one of the big impacts are temperature increases, floods, droughts, and so on. Of course, we had the horrible drought in the Midwest last year as an example. We now do have our first engineered drought-tolerant maize from Monsanto. But if we look at its prospects and the data we have so far, it's very modest at best. Where it can be most useful is under moderate droughts. And if you do the math and look at the areas where this is considered to be most useful, and some of this is from USDA, its analysis itself, it's probably reduces yield loss by about 1% in a typical year. By contrast, if you look at economist Bruce Babcock's work looking at historical data, he estimates that under similar kinds of drought, breeding and agronomy have improved drought tolerance over the last 30 years by about 1% per year under these kind of conditions. And that leads me to the other point I want to make. And before I get there, there's a number of conventionally bred drought-tolerant crops, a bunch of varieties of corn, sorghum, cassava, rice, wheat, are all benefiting from conventional breeding. So why should we care about that? Can't we do everything? And yes, we probably can to some extent. But I think there are opportunity costs we need to consider. Breeding, and especially as informed by newer molecular methods that don't include genetic engineering, is as fast as genetic engineering, and it's not just because of the regulatory burden. You have to the steps you go through take on average 10 to 15 years to develop a well-tested engineered crop, engineered trait. Okay, thank you. So these we now know that there's a tremendous untapped genetic potential in conventional breeding. It's cheaper than genetic engineering. And importantly, agroecological approaches, which are largely neglected because I think we're focusing on other technologies like genetic engineering and having probably too much discussion about them, are being highly underfunded. So this is work on the Marsden Farm, farm scale, work at Iowa State University, long-term, looking with a team of economists, agronomists, weed scientists, and others, comparing good agroecological practices to, in this case, not just genetic engineering, conventional agriculture, including genetic engineering. The take-home messages here are that the yield advantage for good crop rotations compared to using genetic engineering, the yield advantage about 14% in these studies. Net returns to labor about 12% higher for good crop rotations. And importantly, when we talk about things like nitrogen use efficiency, drought tolerance, and so on, these systems use over 90% less nitrogen fertilizer and other fertilizers, over 90% less pesticide measured as herbicides, and so on. And yet, we only spend about 2% of our research budget looking at these systems in conventional breeding. So we need to think about opportunity costs. It's not an argument against genetic engineering. It's an argument that we need to put more of our research and incentive dollars behind technologies that work now, that we know work, that can resolve many of these problems efficiently and productively, and with lower impacts. And so, again, my contention is not that we get rid of genetic engineering or so on and so forth, and I do have some concerns about risks that, conventional risks about eating the crops or so on that differ a little bit from Nina. My contention is that if we don't deal with these huge agricultural challenges by following strong agroecological principles and developing them and making them more efficient, that we're not going to be able to address the issues through genetic engineering. And I'll just finish by saying that most of the traits that have been developed so far are what we call single dominant genes. They're low-hanging fruit, genetically easier to do. Traits like drought tolerance, yield, and so forth are genetically and physiologically much more complex. And so, in terms of looking at the future, the single gene approaches, even for things like transcription factors that affect the expression of many other genes, so you can have one gene that controls the function of many other genes. Even for those systems, because of the complexity of these traits, what I expect to see is small, modest, incremental progress on the order of what we've seen with Monsanto's drought-tolerant corn, which is quite modest. And so again, the issue to me is do we do what we need to do to move agriculture in a direction that addresses these big challenges, these huge public health and environmental impacts that agriculture has now, maintain and increase productivity, or do we focus too much, on, as I would contend we're doing right now, on genetic engineering at the expense of these other approaches? And I think we'll have the opportunity, I hope, to get into some of the other risk issues a little later. Okay, thank you.
I'm the lone animal guy in the crowd, I think. Like Professor Fedoroff, I've been doing this since 1983, working with transgenic animals. So there's actually a lot that I've been experiencing in this debate over the many, many years that I've been doing it. So I'm probably not going to actually take the full time here. We need to back up. No, here I'll do it. Should just click right there, and it should go. So I'm just going to give you a very brief place of where animals are, because we've heard mostly about plants. And the first thing I would say, in contradicting my host, is that for animals, FDA regulation is mandatory. Or at least if you talk to the FDA, it's mandatory. Not true for plants, it's true for animals. They are regulated under different paradigms, different laws, and they're regulated a little bit differently. So for the animals, it is a mandatory to go through the FDA. So I just want to give you a really brief kind of overview of where we're at and my take on the good and the risks. G animals for agriculture were first produced, genetically engineered livestock were first produced in 1985. That included rabbits, sheep, pigs, and carp in China in 1985. So we've had genetically engineered food animals for that long, but there's none on the market today. So we have, and so that's one of the issues we have. Over 60 different constructs. I'm not talking about the number of events, because when you make a transgenic line, particularly in the olden days when we did it by pronuclear microinjection and it randomly inserted, you would create a number of lines, and then you would pick to maintain and study the best of those lines. So many, many different, more animals were made than this, but 60 different constructs, by my count, and there's a recent review paper by Scott Fahrenkrug's group out of Minnesota, which summarizes all of this, were produced for use in agriculture. Not biomedicine, not xenotransplantation. Those are two other applications. So those modifications include a lot of things. Modifying milk to increase the nutrition or the functional properties of milk. Some of my own work where we're trying to actually produce milk that is high in human proteins that are antimicrobial to impact childhood diarrhea in the third world, which is actually more devastating than vitamin A deficiency. Modification of wool growth, as you can imagine. Australia, New Zealand started work in that area. Uruguay has recently started a project in that area, speaking of Uruguay. Improved growth, sustainability, and again, the biggest challenge that agriculture scientists have in the future, and it's certainly in the next 10 years, but going out even further, is how do we increase production without degrading the environment? We're going to have less land and less water as we have more people, and we have to produce food. So we have to increase the efficiency of production of food in a sustainable manner. And so improving growth and feed efficiency increases sustainability in and of itself, because you're producing more food per unit of input. And so we'll come back to that in a minute. Improved digestion nutrition, that's really the EnviroPig. What you're really doing is removing phosphorus. You're actually making something which is environmentally more sustainable by decreasing a serious pollutant, second after nitrogen. And then disease resistance, animal health. So this really goes to animal welfare, as well as, again, productivity. If animals are sick, if they're in under health pressure, they're not as productive. If they're not as productive, you're putting in more resources for the unit that you're getting back out. Potentially good animals available today. I dropped the animals out of that, GE animals, because that's what I'm talking about here. And this is by no means meant to be exhaustive. I have a reason why I picked these four examples. The Aqua Advantage salmon increases sustainability of production. Also, almost any fisheries expert will tell you that we're more and more going to rely on aquaculture and less rely on wild-caught fish. Atlantic salmon now is an entirely aquaculture-based industry. If you're eating wild Atlantic salmon, that's probably because you're in some part of the world where you can still go out with a rod and catch it yourself, because there's not a sustainable fishing industry for Atlantic salmon. They're all aquaculture. The EnviroPig, again, it had environmental sustainability implications. The bovine lactalbumin pigs, this is one you haven't heard of. These were produced at the University of Illinois. They basically increased milk production in a sow. Why is that important? We have bred the animals, and the animals in themselves produce large litters. And the smallest pigs in the litter usually die for lack of food or getting crushed by the sow or whatever. But in fact, about 20% of baby pigs that are born die for lack of food. The sow can't produce enough milk. So by putting in bovine lactalbumin, this is the enzyme in the mammary gland that actually puts lactose in milk, and lactose is what puts water in milk, and therefore the sow produces more milk, and therefore you have an animal welfare application as well as a production application.
You increase the feed efficiency of those pigs after they're weaned, and so they are more efficient. And then the last one's my own human license on transgenic goats, which, as I said, are actually trying to address a human health concern, and they don't have a sustainability issue for the animals themselves, although you could argue they probably have a better health of their own mammary gland system. Oops, wrong button, which I do all the time on computers. So the reality today, to be very clear about it, no GE animal products have been approved for food anywhere in the world today. There are way more examples than my four that could be. I would argue those four examples, which are all North American based, have exhaustive studies done on them. They are all have been shown to be safe. They are healthy animals. They are all in sixth generation or older now, descendants of the original transgenic animals. The first measure of health of an animal is it a healthy animal? Does it grow normally? Does it reproduce normally? Does it breed normally? These animals do that. They have done it for multiple generations. So they would be considered healthy animals by an FSIS vet who was inspecting them before they went into a slaughter plant. I like this Henry Miller quote, so I put it up. The current regulatory regimes are unscientific, technique-based, and require case-by-case review for virtually all genetically engineered plants and microorganisms, put animals in there as well, no matter how obviously trivial the modification or benign the product might be. We have overregulated to death. So what are the risks? Well, my personal belief is that GE livestock, poultry, and fish will be necessary to feed the world in the future. Does that mean we don't do animal breeding? Of course not. It is simply a technique. It has applications which make sense. There are applications where it does not make sense. But it's a technique that can be used. It can be used efficiently in some situations, and to not use it is throwing the baby out with the bathwater. And the greatest risk to me is that we won't use the technology. And in the 30-odd years I've been doing this, and the 20-odd years we've been in the big debate, we talk about the risks, the hypothetical risks, which I completely agree with, all the time. We don't talk about the very real potential benefits, and in many cases, demonstrated benefits. That is a conversation that occurs with the scientists at the scientific meetings having a beer, does not occur usually in the public debates and in the public policy debates. And my last slide for this particular issue is to show you where sites of GE livestock are going around today. My old starting grounds in Sydney, Australia, you'll notice completely blank. Africa is blank. Europe is blank, with the exception of the Roslin Institute, which is the lone holdout. And in North America, of those five stars, two of them are actively doing stuff for agriculture. The other ones want to, but really aren't because they can't get the funding. But look at South America is now growing. Look at China. So the technology is here. The technology is worldwide. The technology will be applied somewhere. If not here, then somewhere else. So our question really is, how do we manage it to get the most usefulness out of it? I don't believe there really is a risk to the animals, particularly animals. Very hard to create an animal which is toxic, because the animal dies. Animals don't have natural toxins like plants. It's not that you can somehow miraculously turn on a toxin gene in an animal. Other than the platypus, which we don't eat, there are no toxin genes in animals, in mammals, in food animals. They don't have toxin genes. So it's a very different scenario. And yet we are over-regulating these techniques to the extent that they're disappearing in the Western world, but they're going to be taken up in the developing world because they need the benefits. And we do too 10, 15 years from now. And keep in mind, if you have an application that the best way to get it into cattle is to genetically engineer it and you start today, you're probably a decade away because of the reproductive nature of the animal from having animals you can put into agriculture. So if we want to decide in 10, 15, 20 years we're going to use the technology, we're going to be using it 10 or 15 years after that. Because you cannot take an animal which has a 9-month gestation and a 15 months to maturity and rapidly get that disseminated. You just can't do it. So I will end there. Turn it over to Ron.
The question before us is labeling, which has been controversial, largely because with respect to DG animals in particular, FDA's policy is FDA's view is as an authority to mandate labeling because it's the same fish and a similar position is applied to plants.
Thank you, Randy. I think the key is that you introduced me as counsel. I have a mere, 4.5 minutes to speak, which I think gives you some sense of an economist's view of the relative contribution a lawyer has to make to this discussion. But I thank Randy and RFF for having me here. Delighted to be here to talk to all of you today about this complex and very interesting issue. Randy, I think it wanted me to talk just briefly about kind of the legal framework or regime here and then focus a little bit on the labeling. And I actually want to build off a comment that Randy made at the outset when he was doing his introductory slides about the degree to which the technology here, in some respects, has overtaken a bit the legal framework that Congress originally created. And it is a sense in which we're trying to fit a square peg into a round hole. And I think it also has to be understood in the context that Professor Fedoroff so thoughtfully talked about, which was this kind of emotional aspect here as well. So what we have is a legal framework that it may be adequate, and we'll discuss its adequacies, but maybe is not perfect against a backdrop of a public that is very wary in some respects, for all the reasons that the prior commenters have discussed about the implications and realities of genetically modified foods. And what's interesting about this, at least from my perspective as an attorney, is the kind of the emotional connection people have to animals versus crops. The reality is we've all been eating genetically engineered crops for much of our lives. Certainly some have been concerned about this work from the outset, but it has not generated nearly the sense of kind of anxiety and public attention, as has this idea that we might eat something that is genetically modified that has lips and eyes and breathes. And one of the things I want to clarify quickly just about the historical regulation of crops, to get at the point that Jim and Randy made, is the agency's policy is not so much voluntary as it is just a different way in the plant world of evaluating the safety of these genetically modified crops than it is in the animal world. And the paradigm in which the agency does it is the food additive framework. And the idea is that if someone wants to add something to a food, then the way to demonstrate that it is safe to the agency is to file with it a petition to treat that as a food additive. And there's actually quite a bit of scientific analysis that goes into demonstrating that food is indeed safe for use as a food additive. But there is a big exception, and that is you don't need to go through the food additive process if the product you have is generally recognized as safe, which is a term of art used in legal circles, but essentially means this is a really safe manipulation. When we, as a technical matter, add spaghetti sauce to noodles, when we add sugar to cereal, we are actually engaged on some theoretical level in kind of a food additive type activity. We're adding one food to another. The agency doesn't regulate that because we all regard that as generally recognized as safe. In virtually all of, not all of, but in virtually all of the genetic modifications of crops, the agency has actually regarded those as grass, has not insisted that food additive petitions be submitted to the agency, has regarded the removal of enzymes, the cross injection, you can see I'm not a scientist, but grafting of enzymes from one plant to another as typically falling within this GRAS framework. And so when Randy was discussing the voluntary process in his slides at the outset that is used to evaluate this, typically what happens is companies are allowed to file petitions with the agency that say, in effect, I think what I'm doing falls within the GRAS exception to the food additive framework. Don't you agree? And then the agency will, in a kind of wonderfully legal way, say, we are not reaching a final definitive decision, but please go forth and market as though you're GRAS. And that's widely understood and interpreted to be a blessing. And so off it goes. There are exceptions to this, of course. And I don't want to suggest that genetically modified crops have not gone through the food additive process, because some indeed have. But it is different than, as Jim described, the legal framework that exists in the case of animal drugs. And the way that the agency has chosen to evaluate the safety and effectiveness of the aqua bounty fish, and at least for all genetically modified animals moving forward until further notice, is through the new animal drug approval process. And so essentially what happens is that a company comes to the agency, files an application saying that they are doing something that affects the structure function of the animal's body. In this case, it would be genetic modification. And the agency evaluates that, and they evaluate whether or not that is safe and effective for the animal. They also ask whether or not it's safe or effective for that animal to be consumed by humans. And as I think most of you are well aware, they also engage in environmental impact assessment in certain instances to evaluate the environmental implications of the behavior or of the proposed modification to the animal. And so that's the framework under which the agency is evaluating these genetically modified animals at the moment. And that's certainly, as I think all of us know, the framework under which they are evaluating the aqua bounty salmon. And so an obvious question that arises is that an adequate legal framework? Is it too much of a round peg a square peg in a round hole? Is it adequate? I don't suppose to answer that definitively for anyone. I think it's a very interesting and open question. My own sense is that the new drug animal drug approval process has been more than adequate in the current instance with Aqua Bounty, because by all accounts, Aqua Bounty has been incredibly cooperative with the agency in giving the agency everything it wants to address any kind of a lingering scientific question it may have. And so with respect to the real issue before us, the salmon, which detractors call the frankenfish, the question is this an adequate approval mechanism? My answer is, based on the cooperativeness of the company, most likely yes. Yes, it is. But is it a perfect pathway? My view is it is not, because even if, and I'm assuming there will be the approval of the aqua bounty salmon, questions still linger for the future, important regulatory questions. Is the environmental impact analysis adequate enough to be used again and again and again, maybe with companies that are less cooperative than Aqua Bounty? What do we do about the regulation of the offspring of the genetically modified animal? And Jim and I were having an interesting discussion about this just before the panel began. Typically, what's being consumed is the offspring of the genetically modified animal. FDA asserts that those offspring are subject to the same rules that adhere in the case of the transgenic animal itself. But there's an interesting legal question, frankly, about whether or not that is a really solid legal theory, whether that's an attenuated connection, whether or not that would be subject to some sort of legal challenge. And so imagine, if you will, someone engaged in the genetic engineering of animals abroad, trying to sell those animals into the United States. These are the offspring now of the genetically modified animal. And someone challenges the current approval framework and says, hey, look, I acknowledge and concede that the parent is an unapproved new animal drug, or has taken an unapproved new animal drug, as far as you're concerned, as a regulatory body. But how does that speak to the legal status of the third generation animal? Interesting questions. And then also this question about labeling. What exactly are the rules going to be and what's appropriate for the rules to be around the labeling of these genetically modified animals? Can they be labeled as all natural? We can discuss that in the question and answer session. What are the opportunities for companies to basically advertise with prominence the fact that they are selling something that isn't genetically modified? And I think we can look to some precedent that the agency used in the case of growth hormone in milk and other analogs to get some sense to try and infer exactly how the agency thinks it's appropriate to deal with these sorts of issues. The FTC, and we'll be hearing from Pauline in a moment, also has, I'm certain, a lot to say about the appropriate labeling and advertising of these genetically modified animals, and also the negative inferences that can be insinuated by those who would market products that aren't genetically modified. So one thought that I'll leave with you just as we think about the future, because I know one of the things that Randy did want to talk about was where are we going to be in 10 years, which is this year the Congress is going to take up the animal drug user fee reauthorization package. It must pass legislation in that much of the funding that the Center for Vet Medicine and FDA gets is based off user fees that are paid by those who submit new drug animal applications for review. And what always happens in the case of these user fee reauthorizations is that there is an effort to actually do the business of reauthorizing the user fee, and then they also become a vehicle, as must-pass legislation in the FDA space, for important kind of policy and scientific issues related to the subject matter at issue. And so what's so interesting is that we find ourselves, just by a kind of wonderful historical accident, on the precipice of a GE animal approval by FDA and a vehicle that must pass through the U.S. Congress this year to reauthorize the work that CVM does. That will no doubt be a magnet for the kind of legislation that Randy alluded to before, which just deals simply with these questions of labeling. But also, it'll be interesting to see whether or not anyone proposes a new pathway, approval pathway, by which to evaluate genetically modified animals, how, if at all, that spills into the issue of genetically modified plants, and then importantly, what will any new pathway or any new debate on this issue raise in terms of these kind of consumer right to know and labeling issues. So very interesting time for all of these issues to be discussed, a confluence of different events both legislatively and in the executive branch, and happy to talk further about it at the Q&A session, and delighted to be here. So thank you.
Just so you know, you're in Washington. Before I begin speaking, I'm obliged to say that my opinions are my own and I'm not speaking for my agency. And before last Friday, when I talked to Randy about filling in for whoever couldn't come, I do not know the science in this area. And so what I'm going to say today is based on how we would approach any science-based issue as it relates to consumer labeling, consumer advertising. So I know very little, don't quiz me. Okay, so at the FTC, we regulate all consumer labels and all consumer advertising, including food labels, but we have a sort of gentleman's agreement with the FDA that FDA has primary jurisdiction over food labels. Okay, we don't have the authority to ban products from the marketplace, typically. We do have authority to regulate what you can say about those products and how you can or should or must label those products. And so we face all kinds of science-based issues as it relates to consumer products and have to decide when should we require a mandatory label, when should we prevent a claim, when should we cause a claim to be changed, augmented, How do we think about those things? Because of the scope of our regulatory authority, we've had to do it in a very general way. So if we were going to think about a product where we were contemplating requiring a label or requiring a disclosure in an ad, we could do that in one of two ways. Either we could argue that the product was being deceptively marketed if it didn't include certain information, and that would be under our deceptive statutes, or it was unfair to market the product without the disclosure. The unfairness is more of a cost-benefit test. So deception, we would say, under our deception policy statement, we would say not including certain information is deceptive if the omission is likely to mislead consumers acting reasonably in the circumstances to the consumer's detriment. So what are those elements? It's that it's not some fringe of consumers. It's not a few consumers. It's not a, you know, small segment of the consumer base. It's the typical consumer who is being marketed. So if you're aiming at children, it's the children. If you're aiming at adults, food purchasers, it's the typical food purchaser. Acting reasonably in the circumstance. So it's not some far-fetched potential explanation, interpretation. It's a reasonable consumer. And then the most important element is to the consumer's detriment. So it's a core concept of injury. If it doesn't injure the consumer, it's not of interest. And to economists, injury means they would do things differently if they knew. Not they would sleep better at night. They would make different choices if they knew. And then how big? Okay, under unfairness, this is a very general authority, frightening authority when you really think about it. Whatever the agency, five votes, declares to be unfair is illegal. So Congress has put some meat on that over the years, and so has the agency. For unfairness, you have to argue that omitting this information on a label or in an ad causes injury. That injury has to be substantial, not reasonably avoided by consumers themselves, not outweighed by countervailing benefits to consumers or to competition. So it's a three-pronged test, but again, injury is a core issue. Consumers have to be injured by not having the information. Not outweighed by countervailing benefits. Let me say a couple of things about that because it would relate to an issue like this. What if some consumers are doing just fine, but a small segment of consumers aren't getting the message? Well, you know, then you have to start trading off across consumers. So, you know, I see this. I've worked a lot on health claims for food products. Suppose you put a health claim on a food label or in a food ad, and it's useful information to most consumers, and they get it, and they make better choices as a result. But some small segment of consumers misunderstands. Is that enough to prohibit the claim? We would be weighing, well, how big is the gain? How big is the potential injury? And could the injury be avoided by a clearer claim? Okay, so when we would look at an issue like this, these animals, we would start with the science. What does the science say? Is this a harmful, is this product potentially harmful? Is it potentially beneficial? How certain is the science? How big is the injury? How big is the potential gain? We would try to, you know, assess what the scientific basis is for the claims about the product. If it turns out that the product had significant harms, potentially, especially for a significant portion of that group of the target consumers, we might require disclosure. But it would have to be significant injury for enough consumers that without that disclosure, people would make decisions they wouldn't otherwise make. But even if we met the scientific standard that said this is important information, there are real issues here as consumers make choices, we would do another analysis before we mandated the disclosure. Why won't the market deal provide this information? How do we assure ourselves that we need to do federal intervention? Why, in this kind of case, why would the non-GE salmon not disclose that they were non-GE salmon if enough people cared about it? What is the argument for the federal government mandating the disclosure? Now, you might think, since I have all these scientists in front of me, what's the difference? You're getting the disclosure one way or the other, right? The difference is a dynamic difference. Over time, if the issue goes away and the science gets better, you don't need the disclosure anymore. Or if the genetically engineered salmon are the only salmon on the market, you don't need the disclosure anymore. The market tends to evolve much more dynamically than federal regulatory requirements do. Once a mandated disclosure is in, it's in for your children's children. Okay. And sometimes it can do harm. A classic example in the food area is the standards of identity for dairy products. You know, what is the definition? There was a federal definition of ice cream. And good ice cream, had to have a minimum butterfat content. When they were trying to measure quality, that's what determined good ice cream. Of course, that's before we knew what saturated fat did to our arteries. And so as people started trying to develop light ice cream, there was a big fight because you couldn't call it ice cream. And you had to call it frozen dairy product or some other thing, which made it much, much harder to market. You know, you'd think people would learn, but it made it harder to market. And obviously there was a vested interest who had no interest in getting rid of the butterfat requirement for dairy, for ice cream. And so for 15 years, even though FDA knew that it would be better to change that requirement, everybody in the policy community understood the issue, it just was not worth the resources to get it done. So there is a difference in mandating the disclosure as opposed to facilitating the disclosure. So I guess I'll stop talking there, but that's the main reason why I'm here.
Could we turn off the projector, please? Thank you. And would my panelists join me on the stage? And I have a few questions to ask of my own prerogative as moderator of the panelists. And then we have an opportunity for members of the audience to ask questions themselves. We're also being broadcast live on the web, so I'd like to welcome those viewers joining us via webcast and invite those viewers to submit questions on Twitter using the hashtag AskRFF. We'll collect the questions we receive and address some of those during our Q&A session from the audience in a few minutes. And I'm told those will be delivered to me by hand. I had a follow-up question that I'd like to ask to Paulina Polito of the FTC. And from my perspective as a former agency official, I was always nervous when judgments about policy were unfettered except according to the subjective best instincts of the officials in the room. And with respect to labeling, not of the GE product itself, but instead the conventional food that might compete with it, the claims that might be made, in principle, could suggest a better than connotation. In the case of a GE animal, there might be a suggestion that the conventional salmon is healthier than the non-GE salmon, a suggestion that it's better for your health. And one way of approaching that would be through an empirical study where one asks consumers what they think and how it might change their behavior. So specifically, and one can imagine this in the case of the GE salmon, that there's a to use that example to make it concrete. So would empirical studies of consumer comprehension provide a sound basis for the FDA or for any agency such as the FTC to decide whether use of potentially misleading words may be natural or maybe healthier than is inappropriate in the context of your regulatory background?
Okay, well, let me start first with the regulatory side of that question. Okay, can you hear me? Okay. No? All right. Is this on? Yes? Well, let me talk loudly then. If a product, any product, like a traditional salmon, wanted to advertise that it was better than some other product, we do what I just described. And as part of our normal advertising law and labeling law, the presumption is that if a firm makes a claim, they have to have a reasonable basis, legal term, reasonable basis for the claim. And if it's a science-based claim, that means there's a scientific basis for the claim. So if a conventional salmon were to say, we're better for you because we're not genetically engineered, we will immediately ask for the scientific basis that supports that claim. All right? So, now, you could say different things. You could say, this salmon is a naturally grown salmon. It is not genetically engineered. And stop talking. Okay? That is a fact. It's a fact that may be of interest to people. You're not claiming why it would be of interest to them. That's where you run into trouble. Unless there's science that says, here's why you should care. So the way advertising law, labeling law works, we ask, what is the claim you are making, and what is the basis for that claim? And so I think that's a very important thing to understand as you think about how an issue like this would play out in the market. Now, in terms of consumer responses, usually we like to see how do consumers, real people, not all of you, not us, real people understand claims in a natural market setting. That's usually a very good type of information for us. It helps us make better decisions, except in this kind of circumstance. Or one of the things to worry about is this kind of circumstance. Consumers do not understand the situation very well. In fact, it sounds very frightening. Mutations are bad. Franken is bad. To go out and survey consumers then and ask them what they think of certain kinds of claims, do you think a genetically modified fish is good for you or bad for you? They're likely to say bad for them on the basis of nothing real. Now, if we were going to do a consumer survey in this kind of circumstance, and we have for certain kinds of health-related issues, one of the things we would require as a control is what we would call the information control. In one page, try to write out as accurate, unbiased, and fully informative description of what the true state of the science is. So in this circumstance, you might say, this is a new technology, never been introduced into the food supply. However, all the scientific studies show that the fish seem to be exactly the same as other wild-grown fish. But of course, it's a new technology, and all new technologies might have risks, unknown risks. Okay, let's say something like that. Given that, how do consumers interpret this? Facts, how do they react to the choices of these two fish, and then compare it to other kinds of claims. At least you've got a shot then of trying to understand, you know, how they would react if they better understood what the reality was, which is scientifically we can't see any difference, but it is a new technology.
Thank you. I'm going to ask one more question, then I think we'll take questions from the audience. So this one's a little bit. Let me ask this question, and then we'll loop back to questions from the audience. So no answers yet, please. I'll just put it out there for you to think about. Okay, and this is, I've described the FDA process of review of GE plants as voluntary, and Bill has elaborated on that. And there's some critics of that who've suggested, and you've heard some of that today, that it hasn't identified risks that are significant and worth leading to decisions to prevent products from being to market. So given that this is an expensive process, and it requires federal resources, federal budget times are tight, there's a sequestration going on, should funding for that process be cut for the purposes of economizing on federal resources? And I'll put that, I think I limit this only to Doug, to Nina, and to Jim. And then I'll take questions from the audience, and they can loop back to an answer on this later. Please come up and identify yourself, and if you'd like to speak into the mic, then everyone will be able to hear you without my repeating the question. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Brooks Yeager, and about 15 years ago, due to circumstances that were partially out of my control, I was the lead negotiator for the U.S. for the Biosafety Protocol. And I'm curious, it's been a very interesting panel, but I actually am curious about a different level of question about biotechnology. Because what struck me most about the panel was how sterile the debate over biotechnology seems to be in the United States. This is the same debate that was going on 15 years ago, almost identically. And not only that, the same background facts. So the overview of the technology that our moderator produced, which was quite interesting, listed as benefits the same hypothetical crops that would be good for the same hypothetical third world consumers as were listed by the biotechnology industry in defense of biotechnology 15 years ago. None of those crops have come forward. And in fact, the only crops that have come forward are the ones that reduce costs, at least temporarily, for American farmers. So I'm curious, is there something wrong with the biotechnology market? Is there something wrong with the economic incentive? Is there something more complex about biotechnology that really would benefit third world children? Or is it just that we're dealing with an industry that's out to make short-term money, and we are never going to realize the ultimate benefits of biotechnology?
Thank you, Mr. Yeager. What I'd like to do is take two more questions and then go through the panel to respond all at once. So please.
And we have to remember the questions.
I'll repeat them.
Hi, my name's Scott Borges. I had a long experience in the environmental and energy process over the last 30, 40 years. I'm going to ask a more general question. You don't have to answer it now at some time, but it seems to me this is just yet another type of experience of what I call economic Ludditeism, except where you don't have workers going out to build, to destroy machinery. We have voters and lawyers and people on both sides of scientific equations saying, is this good for you or bad for you, and how do you scare people, or how do you make them useful? My question, perhaps is a question for sociologists, historians, I don't know, maybe psychologists. What have we learned over the last 20-odd years in this part of the whole equation that will lead us to perhaps do something differently in the past? Make it broader and say, can we learn from other different scientific issues in other similar but not exact systems? Because unless we get to that question, we haven't even asked the question yet. And I'm not sure anybody wants to ask the question because no one wants to know what the answer is. And so we're kicking the can down the road, in my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. Dallas, short question.
Dallas Birchart, Resources for the Future here. I think that the intuition of the general population is informed sort of vaguely by a concern about the industrial ecology that surrounds GMOs. And so, you know, the nature of the industry that's going to build up around a GMO agribusiness. And, you know, you hear concerns about seed drift so that such a GMO crop infiltrates an organic farm or some other crop patterning nearby that doesn't have the GMO, but then that seed is wrecked, or that a monoculture-based aquaculture is a breeding ground for some kind of disease, and then you have a narrow gene pool that's very susceptible and that could go out and infect a wild population. So these are hypothetical concerns, too, to some degree. I don't think the seed drift thing, I think there's examples about that. So I was wondering if you could expand a little bit of talk about the context of the industrial ecology that's going to might build up around GMOs.
Okay, thank you. Let me take one from Twitter, and I'll review them all, and then we'll go down through the panel. Thank you for who's ever sent us this from Twitter. I don't have a hashtag, I guess it is, or a name, but the question is very closely related to Dallas's. With the high regulatory costs for GE organisms, I guess it's for developing GE organisms, how can small companies compete against big corporations? So the questions are, my own was the process of voluntary GE approval at FDA sensible, given a world of scarce resource constraints? Mr. Yeager's, isn't this a sterile debate? Haven't we heard all these facts before, and isn't something wrong in that there's been no development of the promised health-promoting, environmentally protective crops that were promised 10 years ago? Mr. Forrester's, isn't this a question of Ludditism? What have we learned today from other similar scenarios to make us more more quickly develop a solution here, and then the industrial ecology one of Dallison from the web? And why don't I go from my the far side, Pauline, to the near side? And you can pick and choose among these and address only the ones that you want, if any. So you can say none of the above as a choice. And we have 10 minutes left, 11.
Okay, well, I'm going to be very quick because this is for the scientists mostly. But the one thing that I would, from what we've learned in terms of regulating health claims for foods in general, there's a great temptation to say we shouldn't allow things until we're really sure, really, really sure. And that means a lot of nothing happens, and firms move on to other things. And, you know, to the extent that you're talking about things that are beneficial overall, letting claims go provides incentives for firms to change the products they make, and changing the products they make in ways that are beneficial to focus on things like health and nutrition issues, yield, and so on. Cost. I mean, someone I remember before said, well, it's just cost saving. Well, I don't know what kind of household you run, but for most consumers, cost is a very nice thing to reduce. So allowing firms to promote, to focus on the characteristics that are desirable to consumers in as truthful a way as we can at a reasonable cost is actually a good and something that we should be careful about. But I turn it over to the scientists who know about this stuff, really.
Okay, so a whole bunch of questions which I probably already have forgotten. On the FDA issue, no, I wouldn't. I would actually go in the other direction, contrary to Dr. Fedoroff's explanation, which I agree with to some extent. I don't expect most of these crops to be harmful to eat. And I guess I differ as well from the perspective that, you know, there's a general benefit. So far, the technology has not done anything of great of benefit to consumers, either in terms of cost to consumers or health benefits or anything else. Let me just address one quick one that Nina brought up in terms of mycotoxins. That's one potential health benefit, but in the U.S. it's not an issue because we screen, it's more an economic issue, we screen for those fumonisins, the particular mycotoxins that have been identified. But again, I want to look at this technology in part in terms of opportunity costs and the trade-offs with other technologies. Texas A&M, they've developed mycotoxin-resistant maize, and it's not only resistant to fumonisin, but also aflatoxin, which BT does nothing for. So we also have to consider this in terms of the context of what's available besides genetic engineering, and I would contend you can even look at papaya, which has been a success story of virus-resistant papaya in Hawaii. We've recently, breeders have been able to move resistance to that virus from a wild relative of a papaya into papaya, and they think it will probably have broader resistance than the one in Hawaii, which is resistant to a single strain. So we have to look at that context. But in terms of the risk issues, the way I would look at it is that while many of these, I think, will be safe, some of them, depending again on the type of gene and so on, could be risky. And when we're talking about food, we're talking about mandatory virtually exposure to the entire population. So I look at it a little bit differently. I do try to take the benefit side of it into account. What I don't see right now or into the future that this technology is likely to provide any substantial overall benefits. There may be specific applications where this is the best approach, but in aggregate, in terms of nutrition, in terms of pesticide use, and all of the environmental impacts and so on, I don't see this technology measuring up to breeding, especially as informed by molecular mechanisms. So if you put it in that context, I'm concerned about those occasional risks and having a regulatory system in place that can identify them. And I don't think we have that right now. It's basically, a voluntary system under the GRAS provisions of the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act.
Thank you, Doug. let me give you 15 seconds. I'm trying to move on.
Just wrap it up. So because of that, I think the key is how do we regulate smartly so that we don't put too much of a burden. Can we try to identify those traits that may be less of a risk up front, perhaps, and focus on the ones that are more of a risk? But I think we need a mandatory system that is smarter and that can identify those traits that are of higher risk.
Thank you. Jim.
I certainly don't remember the first question, but I'll hit the other four very quickly. the debate being sterile, yes, it is. Why is it? I think that's because the opposition has demagogued. They don't pay attention to facts. Seeds of Deception is recently out as a movie and was prominently featured on the Dr. Oz show, for any of those who happen to watch it. And it's rife with inaccuracies. And the scientists have accumulated facts and accumulated much data showing safety, and the debate hasn't changed because the opposition won't let it. And so I think that's one of the issues. This morning, I'm in my hotel room. I put on the news while I'm getting dressed, and what do I hear? But on, I don't remember the news show, that they had nutritionists on, and they were talking about how your caramel latte, whatever it is from Starbucks, which I don't drink, has six different kinds of sugar in it, five of which are GMO. It is a pejorative term.
Well, pardon me, but that wasn't the question. The question was, why is it that the technology has failed to deliver the consumer benefits, particularly for the poor in the third world, that were claimed for 15 years ago, but it's only delivering the benefits for American farmers?
I think part of that...
And even those, as Doug pointed out, seem to be...
I'm going to be very brief.
Time's with the panel. Jim, go ahead.
I would argue that, in fact, it's because many parts of the world have chosen not to use this into demagogy. But anyway, that's my take on it. In terms of being neo-Luddites, I think that's exactly what's happening. It's a technology which is trying to be destroyed rather than trying to see how it can be used. It gets back to my comment, the benefits are not being talked about. Golden rice has been available for some time.
10 years.
Would provide 10%, 12% of the vitamin A. And as soon as it got to the point where that was true and there was no other objection, the objection was it doesn't solve the whole problem, so we shouldn't use it. I'm sorry, that's just where that goes with me. Industrial ecology, yes, we have industrial farming. And I'm not sure how we can be productive enough to feed 9 billion people if we don't. And I'm not sure how GM plays any differently than using radiation-induced mutations, in which there is a canola out there that is glyphosate resistant that was bred in Australia from radiation mutation, and it can be grown anywhere in the world, and nobody cares if that resistance spreads to the wild relatives in the hedgerows. But they do the GE version. So again, we have to be consistent, and I think the regulatory costs do severely impact the small player. There's exactly one company that I'm aware of in the world that has moved into trying to market a GE animal, and that's Aqua Bounty. And 12 years later, they have no regulatory approval. and they have hemorrhaged a lot of dollars. And that is a big red flag for any company. Why would you go into this business? And small companies don't. And there are no large companies backing the animals.
Thank you, Bill.
Professor Fedoroff clearly has some things to say, so I'm going to be very brief. I'll just say I agree with Jim that the costs of entry into this space are prohibitively high for the person on the web who's listening to this. This user fee discussion on the Hill is an opportunity to discuss the barriers to entry, and so I urge you to call your local congressperson. But I think one of the difficulties here is the failure to really kind of make peace with what the appropriate regulatory pathway is, how we are sure we are asking the right questions, and then agreeing on what are legitimate answers. I agree with Jim that there are forces that are preying on fear here in destructive ways, but I don't believe that everybody who opposes, at least viscerally, or has concerns, I should say, viscerally about the science here is demagogue. And I think there are people that have a legitimate point of view who are concerned about whether or not these products are indeed safe. And what's happening is people, for certain economic reasons, I think prey upon that uncertainty in kind of perpetuating and paralyzing the debate, and I think that's truly unfortunate. I do hope that in as much as there is concern about the adequacy of the environmental impacts, inadequacy about those assessments, inadequacy about the labeling, et cetera, that the Congress takes a serious look at that in the next year, because these are not reasons we should not be moving forward.
I think the answer to the question posed by the gentleman who has picked up and left the room is very straightforward. There is the whole demagoguing issue, but frankly, we've done this to ourselves. It costs upwards of $35 million to bring one single, what they call an event, to market. And that's only part of the development costs, which are about three times that. The only crops that can bear that kind of cost are crops that are grown all over the world, the commodity crops. The big biotech companies have made a wise decision to stay with crops that are either non-food crops, cotton, or primarily feed crops, just to stay as much out of the controversy as possible. The real tragedy is not just the small companies, it's the academic scientists in the land-grant universities. There is nothing dangerous about introducing a piece of a virus into a plant, as was done in the papaya. It doesn't even code for a protein. It triggers a normal, it's not an immune reaction, but it's similar to an immune reaction that allows the plant to recognize an incoming virus and destroy it before it wrecks the crop. We should be able to have our academic scientists who work on plants in our land-grant universities and everywhere else working on these problems with local farmers in the developed world and the developing world. We're trying very hard to catalyze connections between developed and developing world scientists. But it's a non-starter if it costs many millions of dollars to get it out and get it through this regulatory apparatus. Now, what's the problem? Why is this debate stuck? It really got stuck for all the right reasons, but it came out wrong. In the mid-80s, I was actually on the recombinant DNA Advisory Committee of the NIH at the time. Recombinant DNA Advisory Committee was advisory. It made no decisions, but it had complete flexibility. Much of the time was spent examining the science and saying, do we know enough to exempt this application from regulation? When regulatory agencies moved in, and I watched it happen, everything got stuck. Now, essentially it was the OSTP, Office of Science and Technology Policy, that put together the committee that gave us the regulatory framework that came out in the late 1980s. Their position was we don't need new legislation, and the new legislation might be worse than what we have now. So go, regulatory agencies, find legislation that we have, which included things like FIFRA, TSCA, the Toxic Substances Control Act. That's the nightmare that we created for all the right reasons of trying to avoid new legislation. But we're stuck there. That's the regulatory framework under which we're now still working. There is no sunsetting process. We need what the OSTP at that time said, and you can go and read the stuff, is there is no evidence that these are dangerous. Let's use the legislation we have now and let's move forward. And regulate based on the properties of the organism. We haven't done that. We have regulated the process, not the product. We need to regulate the product. We need to unload this. We need to figure out, you know, by the time you've gotten BT this and BT that and BT the other, there is no health risk. Why not sunset these? Why not exempt them? We have no exemption process once we start regulating. So frankly, what the demagoguery has done is reinforce this process. The regulatory agencies, in my experience, are afraid to loosen these regulations because people will protest. We're in a feedback loop that is very destructive, and my profoundest concern is that we are indeed throwing away the baby with the bathwater. Rachel Carson, in her book, looked forward to a time when we could do with biology what we were then doing with toxic chemicals. Will that ever happen? I don't know. Not unless we change how we regulate. Thank you.
Please join me in thanking our esteemed panel. So thank you very much.